My name's Caddy, and I'm on the Vancouver Startup Week team. First of all, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge that we're grateful to be virtually gathered on Indigenous land, regardless of where you are joining us from. I am grateful to be on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Squamish peoples. I am privileged to live, work, and play on these lands. First, I would like to thank you for joining us at VSW 2021 and welcome to shaping your path by responding to the community hosted by Frostbites. This session is a part of VSW Founder Track and is proudly supported by Sage Accounting. Sage knows you didn't start your business to become an accountant. Sorry to any accountants out there. Sage Accounting keeps your business organized and running smoothly. Track your cash flow, send out invoice, and get paid quickly. Visit the Sage Accounting booth to access free guides and templates to starting your business finances the right way. Plus, get an exclusive VSW discount if you're ready to switch from Excel. This session is also part of the VSW Experience Package, which we're excited to have for the first time this year. For those who have a box, please feel free to join in on the interactive portion of this session and share your experience with us on social media by tagging us at Vance Startup Week. During the session, if you have any questions for our speakers, please post them under the Q&A on Whova. You can also upvote questions. And now I'll pass the mic over to Peggy and we'll begin.
Hi, everybody. I'm Peggy from Frostbites Syrup Company based in Squamish. And I'm in my showroom right now, which is also our little shop that we have. We just built out our own facility finally after 11 years in business. We built out our own production facility, which came with this awesome, cute little space. A lot of people, when they first meet us, think that we had this really big vision for our business to make soda and cocktail syrup, and that's just not the case. And I just want to kind of give you a little bit of a fun backstory on how a business can evolve. When you start with one idea, you start here and you end up over here, not necessarily with a vision or a mission of your own, but one that is guided by all the input that your customers are giving you. So in 2009, my husband and I were in Hawaii, in Kauai, and my husband, he loves to travel to eat. That's his whole thing. Like, so he pre-plans, where is he gonna eat? Where are all the cool spots? Where are the hidden spots? I'm sure a lot of you do the same as well. And we drove around Kauai trying different types of shave ice. Obviously it's Hawaiian, that's all my husband wanted to eat. And I'm not a shave ice fan, I'll be honest with you. It's not my thing, I'm an ice cream girl. And my husband would tuck into these big massive mounds of icy colored whatever. And at the end of it, he would look at me and his mouth would be blue or purple or orange or whatever it is, but it would just, he would look like a clown basically. And it was a little hilarious and also a little annoying. And we got home, we flew back to Vancouver, and literally as we were sitting on the tarmac, he pulls out his phone and he put in Vancouver shave ice. And the first thing that came up was an ad that was placed the day beforehand on Craigslist for a shave ice machine. A gentleman had bought a machine for his high school kids, and he said to them, you're gonna learn a good work ethic and go start a snow cone or shave ice stand. This was, I think he was in Langley, I think that's right. And the kids didn't wanna do it. They were teenagers, they were typical, like, I don't want anything to do with this, this is a stupid idea, and just give me my allowance, I don't wanna work for my money. That's what the dad said to us. And my husband responded and he said, you know, can we come look at it the next day? So we're off the plane, we go, we check out the shave ice machine. And the funny story behind that is I said, oh, I forget what price it was, but I said, oh, you know, we've got to go lower, right? The typical, like, okay, you're going to offer this in cash. You play the good guy, I play the bad guy. We'll see where we can get it. And end of the story is I ended up paying more for the machine because I'm a complete idiot. And when I saw it, I just loved this beautiful, beautiful retro machine. And as the gentleman loaded it into the van, he said, oh, someone's going to make some money with this. And the whole thing was my husband just wanted a shave ice machine. It had nothing to do with starting a business at all. So it sat on our dining room table literally for a year. Every time I mean, it's huge, it's 80 pounds. I'd walk past it and I'd say, well, you know, are you going to do anything with this? And then I'd have friends over and it turned into sort of a glorified margarita machine. And then we would make snow cones for the kids in the neighborhood and our nieces and nephews. And a year went by and my husband, he was working in the hotel business in Whistler. And I was a chef on the road. I cooked for musicians. That was my job for 20 years, was I was a tour chef. And he calls me in a state, and I happened to be in South Africa, and I was going to come home for 2 weeks and then fly back out to Asia. And he said, I can't do my job anymore. I cannot work at the hotel. And I'm sure all of you can relate a little bit that we get to the point sometimes where we're at our job and we're just like, why are we here? And this is not what I want to be doing. This is not my purpose. And I said, quit, just quit. Go do something with your shave ice machine. And he thought that was a ridiculous idea. And I flew home 2 days later. And in the 2 weeks that I was home, we put a business together and we literally came up with the name, hence why it's called Frostbites, is because of the snow cones. And we applied to all the farmers markets, but unbeknownst to us, at the farmers markets, you have to make it, bake it, or grow it. That's the mandate. Like, there's no, you can't bring in other people's syrups. You have to make your own syrups. So I whipped out a bunch of syrups, flew to Asia for a couple months, came back. He had started the business and we shaved ice all summer. We just wanted to hang out at the farmers market and regroup, get a better game plan for him, what he was going to do in the future. And also I was looking to come off the road, and because I was gone for about 6-7 months out of the year, and I wanted to spend more time in Whistler. And it was kind of weird. Like, we couldn't really give a snow cone away. Like, most people looked at it. I'm my own worst marketer, my own worst advertiser. And people would come to the booth. Mothers would come to the booth. They'd see it was a snow cone and they literally would take their kids and steer them away from the booth. And I would sit and I'd make all these little miniature snow cones and hand them out. And of course everybody would eat them and gobble them up and be like, oh no, I can't buy it now. And off they go. And, but then it's, you know, after a couple of months went by, people started to kind of dig it and understand that we were making our own syrups and we were using only local fruits. That was like my thing, is I was like, what is grown here? What can I utilize from the farmers? And it was a good way of me connecting with the farming community and starting to get to know my community because I was never around. And by the end of the summer, we took all our snow cone money and we went on a 5-month road trip to look at other business models because we realized that we liked being a vendor at the market. We liked the community aspect of it. We loved the connection with the farmers. And we looked, I mean, we traveled for 5 solid months across Canada, across the US, looking at food trucks, at farmers market businesses, at other businesses that we thought were great, and thought, well, what can we do together to make a business? It wasn't, we didn't have a passion to be like, we want to be a snow cone stand, or that we wanted to own a taco truck. There was no like real vision to it. So by the end of the trip, we realized we kept coming back to how much fun we had at the snow cone stand. So the next year was the coldest year on record in Squamish, or at least for like 100 years. And I mean, I would be in the middle of July in my puffy coat. And again, couldn't give a snow cone away except for if the temperature got over like 20 degrees. And a friend of mine, he owns a company in Whistler called Nona Pia's. I'm sure some of you must have some in your cupboard. It's a balsamic glaze. And he gave me he gave me 10 cases of bottles. And he said, put your syrups in these bottles, put them on the table and see what happens. And I said, well, this is stupid. It's snow cone syrup. I never thought of it as anything other than snow cone syrup. And he said, put it out there and see what happens. And we did. And we sold out in an hour. Like, it was crazy. I mean, I had hand stamped everything. I hand wrote everything. It was a bit of a joke. Honestly. And we looked at each other and I said, oh, I guess we're going to make, we're going to bottle stuff. Like people kept coming back and asking for more bottles. So we thought, well, all right, I'm not sure what you're doing with it, but here you go. And it was, timing is everything, right? Like you always, when you're starting out with a business, you don't want to look at what everybody else is doing and then be like, oh, I'm going to do that too, right? Like right now, donuts are such a big thing. Well, you kind of missed the trend. You wanted to be doing it like 2 years ago and getting on that track. But you also want to kind of be a part of a group of people who are starting stuff so that you create awareness. Does that make sense to you? Like you want to create a culture around what you're doing. So that hence using the donut thing is everybody's doing donuts right now and it's quite the hype, right? You go over there to try their donuts and back and forth, blah, 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 blah. So syrups for sodas and cocktails were not really a thing, but what was a thing was the SodaStream. And SodaStream had all these syrups out that were full of chemicals. And again, some of them had coloring. And I just couldn't look at anybody's mouth after they drank something like that, where it was a different color. And people were looking for all natural alternatives, especially here in BC, right? We all love all natural. We love organic. We love supporting our farmers. So here we were now making SodaStream syrup. And then 2 years later, the BC laws changed. And then there was craft distillers. So all of a sudden, you know, we were selling to all these people who were just discovering the SodaStream. Like London Drugs would have a sale, and then people were kind of more apt to try and buy a SodaStream. And then they realized after they tried their syrups, they were looking for natural syrups. And because we were at farmers markets probably about 5 days a week in the beginning, people just started glomming onto it. And I dragged my heels. I'm a chef. Like I love creating something different every single day. So the thought of making the same thing every day really was not something I thought I wanted to do. But what I really liked was responding to the customer's wants. So again, people would come back. The farmer's market is a great place to start, especially if you're in a food business. If anybody's looking to start a food business, I recommend doing your time at a farmer's market, and you're going to get great feedback. And your first year, you're going to do quite well, but it's about consistency, coming back and coming back. And people want to know that they're heard. We all want to feel like we're being heard. So our customers were telling us what they wanted, what they liked, of course people will tell you, oh, it's too sweet, or it's too vanilla-y, or it's too this or that. And then you start to, you tailor it. I mean, obviously you're putting your own stamp, or we put our own stamp on it. And I like to think we're quite different than the other syrup companies that have come and gone and are popping up still, or the ones that you buy in the store. And so it wasn't until really about 6 years ago did I get super serious about bottling. And at around that time, Crate and Barrel out of nowhere reached out to me and said, we want to carry you across Canada. And at that time, I was only regionally very close to home. If I could drive to it to a store within 2 hours, you know, we would stock a shelf, but that was it. And we said yes, because I say yes to everything. When an opportunity comes, I start from a place of yes. I don't start from everything's scary. Like every single step you take is scary. But I think one of the things is you've got to look at everything as an opportunity and a challenge, because you're at every step of the way, you are learning something about yourself. You're learning more about your product. You're learning more about your customer base. And if you don't step out of your comfort zone, you're never going to grow, ever. So Crate and Barrel was super scary, but I took the plunge, and we're still partners with them. And they're just waiting for me again, because I'm very slow at moving things forward. I'm very cautious in making big leaps, but they're waiting for us so that we can expand in the US in Crate and Barrel, which is super exciting. And as mentioned before, last year, we finally built out our own production facility. And we're looking in the next 6 months and getting a whole new bottling assembly, which will be able to put out about 4 times the amount of product we're doing now. So there you go. In a nutshell, that's my story. If anybody has any questions, please feel free to ask. Or if I'm missing something in my timeline.
Perfect. Yeah, no, it's... I mean, it sounds like a story of all business owners. You started with something and then the next thing you know, it's completely different. You have to pivot and things like that. So my quick question for you is, COVID hit.
Yeah.
So what, how's that impacting your business? And
interestingly enough, like we had signed the lease on our space in 2019 in the late summer. And I just want to preface, if you're going to build out anything, factor in about 6 months waiting for building permits. And so we waited for about 6 months for building permits. We got our building permit on March 7th of 2020. And on March 23rd of 2020, we were basically mandated to stop everything. We weren't asked to stop. It was all of the people who were fabricating our machinery, all were mandated to stop. So we thought we were done because we also supply to bars and restaurants and they all closed, right? On March 17th, we had gotten pretty much every single event we're involved with. Stores were closing, bars and restaurants closing, and we thought we were done. We just invested all this money for the last 6 months into buying equipment and getting ready for opening up our own production. And I gotta say, this is where it comes into play. The connection that you get at the farmers markets or doing trade shows or doing craft shows. Like if you're a small producer, right? If you're making an artisan product or if you're an artist, the customers rallied to support us. Our online sales went bananas, like completely off the chart, where we had like maybe 3 boxes to ship out something every once in a while. And the next thing you know, we're like scrambling and we're making boxes out of whatever cardboard we had on hand. And people like to drink during COVID. So there was a lot of cocktail making. And I have to say, what a magical experience, a connection, because people were so kind and people were really on social media and showing me what they were making, telling me how they were using the product, giving me recipe ideas. I was giving them, like I spent a ridiculous amount of time on social media connecting with people. But again, it's that experience of with your customer and listening to what they're saying and how they're using your product and starting to tailor things to them. And out of that, you know, we started actually creating new flavors because of the way people were responding to it. And I had all of a sudden this whole new crowd of people across Canada who were contacting me. And
perfect.
It was great. It was awesome.
That's awesome to hear. Yeah, so that ties into the next question. We're getting quite a few interests here wanting to know, how exactly do you come up with flavors? Somebody volunteer to be a taster. So how do you come up with your flavors and, you know, how do you develop the profile of it?
Well, it's really funny. Like when I used to cook on the road, one of the things that I was known for with a lot of the different bands I work for is that I never repeated a meal. Like that was my thing, is I might be on the road with them for 6 months. You would never get the same meal again. And I'm that person who dreams recipes. I dream flavor combinations. I'm constantly, I like to eat. I like to drink. And I've been blessed to be able to travel the world and experience a lot of flavors that a lot of people haven't been exposed to. And honestly, for the first few years, I would just all of a sudden something would hit me and I'd say, I think this can work. And then don't get me wrong, I have made some really terrible, terrible flavors. But you don't know until you kind of do it. The the real funny thing is with social media now, right? You can go on and you can see, you can put in soda syrup or cocktail syrup and you can see all the people all around the world who are doing exactly what you're doing, right? See what kind of flavors they're coming up with. And I was that person. Well, what's everyone else doing? Okay, I'm a person who does not like to copy anybody. If I see that you're making blueberry basil, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to try and come up with my own signature. So that drives me as well to, that takes a lot of flavor combinations out of the mix immediately because I see what other people are doing. But we were in London a couple years ago, my husband and I, and we were walking through Waitrose, which is kind of like the high-end grocery store there. And we walked in and on the shelf, I always look to see what, because cordials is a very British thing. A cordial basically, for those who don't know, a cordial is like a simple syrup. It tends to be much more fruit forward, made with real ingredients and not artificial stuff that you find in normal simple syrups. And it's very British, it's very Swedish, like you find it a lot in Europe. And we were in Waitrose and we were walking along and they had three cordials on the shelf. And it was mango passion fruit, which is our number one seller, raspberry vanilla, our number two seller, and lychee yuzu, our number four seller. So mango passion fruit, you get, a lot of people do mango passion fruit. Raspberry vanilla, you could kind of see somebody coming up with that. Lychee yuzu is not really a common flavor combination. So that's when I realized I had made it, that somebody in England had been watching me and had taken my idea. It was like, I have arrived.
It sounds like you're meant, you're born to do this. Like I've never had ever having a taste profile showing up just like, oh, I'll try to mix this and this together. So it sounds really amazing that you're like, you are capable of doing that.
Well, it's like how it's like a musician can hear certain sounds. Yes. Like, I have a very sensitive palate, so I'm constantly picking up stuff. I'm also not afraid. And I brought in like a little vase of different herbs that I, sorry, somebody just said come to the door, different herbs from my garden. And I'm constantly planting different stuff, pulling it out and chewing on it, right? Because it releases the oils, your nose picks it up, right? As soon as you bite into it, you're getting the aroma. And you can learn a lot from just those simple tasks. A lot of times I just spit it out because it's not that nice, but sometimes I'm like, okay, I can see how this might work with that. And then you just got to try. And I recommend, I really just want everybody to kind of feel they can go into the kitchen and just throw a bunch of things in and just give it a go.
That's amazing. So you've spilled some beans here about, you know, working with bands. Yes. Who's your favorite band to cook for?
Ooh, I can't really say that, but if I were to say it, no. I have to say, I'm kind of dating myself here because I started in the 90s. So the very first band I ever worked for was Blues Traveler. Some of you might know that band, a jam band. And from there, I kind of stayed with like Neil Young and Dave Matthews Band and those kind of bands, like the old, kind of a lot of the older hippier bands, the jam bands. But then I moved into very specialized cooking for specific people for their dietary needs. So I was with Kelly Clarkson for a really long time. And that was, she was my happy place. She was a little bit like a kid sister. So really good fun with her.
That's awesome. Like the name drops. I'm getting messages here saying that people want to be your friend now. She's like, can we get to know her more? It's amazing. So another question that we have is, do you collaborate with like, say, bartenders or any like mixers to come up with recipes using your syrup?
Well, I don't do other people's recipes. We have been asked to co-pack for a lot of different restaurants and bars. And honestly, with the way that COVID has been with supply chain issues, we are even struggling to get enough bottles for ourselves. So bottling for anybody else has been a challenge. And unfortunately, we've had to say no to that. I also, maybe it's ego driven, is these are my flavors and this is what I do. I don't want to necessarily put my, because once you bottle for somebody, even though it will have their logo on it, your name still has to go on it as a manufacturer. It has to say who's manufacturing it, where it's coming from. Now, I'm not incorporated, so I don't have like a number after my business, like, so I can't just use a number. It would be Frostbites on it. And if I don't love the product, like, how do you differentiate, like, how do you kind of say to the person, well, I would bottle your syrup, but I don't really like your syrup, so I don't want to put my name on it. So we've been very mindful on who we collaborate with. Most people are coming to us for our flavors, and then we're supplying them. Again, with COVID, a lot of people were doing, a lot of bartenders were doing these delivery boxes, right? So cocktail kits, and that's been huge. And so we've collaborated a lot with different bartenders and different restaurants and bars to supply them with that.
Out of all the flavors you've done so far, people want to know which one is your favorite. Your favorite, not the most popular, your favorite. And then I guess the one that you like the least.
My favorite is elderflower. Yeah, my flavor is, that's my favorite, hands down, and it's my happy place. And the growing season is only 3 weeks out of the year, and we pick all the flowers ourselves. So unlike that big box store, you know, where you got to buy all the furniture and stuff that has an elderflower, they use natural flavorings. And I believe there's like 8 ingredients in that natural flavoring, and there's no elderflower in it, by the way. We use real elderflower. So it's a 7-day process. We pick it fresh. We have to process it that night. And then it sits for close to 7 days before we bottle it. It is magic to me. It's so much work. Like, it starts next week for us. So if anybody wants to come pick with me, they can come pick with me. But we work around the clock. We pick all day and process all night for those 3 weeks so we can make enough for the year. And in fact, last year, because we were so busy with COVID and stuff, we sold out by Christmas. We didn't get it. But my least favorite is anything with lavender. I used to love it. And it's one of our most popular flavors is we do a Meyer lemon lavender. But even my husband, like, as soon as I pull out the lavender, he's just like, ugh! Yeah.
We're getting comments here because lavender is really good for, like, you know, the scent in the room, and like, it's very relaxing. It's not
a little perfume.
Yeah. So we're getting comments saying how it's like, oh, it's like soap syrup with lavender.
But you know, that's it's certain ingredients, right? People, their palate reads it differently. Like cilantro, it's a proven fact that 40% of people when they eat it taste soap. Not me. I love it. But with lavender, to me, it's hand soap. We say that all the time. But with that said, I want to, like, this is from my lavender bush, like pre-flowers, right? It's just the leaves. This is beautiful. If you ever want to garnish a drink and add like the most delicate of like lavender notes, and it's just pretty, like you can add that into your, you know, into your glass, and it could just be a very simple garnish that you're adding to a martini and giving a light flavor, no soapiness there.
Oh, that's perfect. So your product, you said it's going through, you know, online sales. Are you in any stores?
Yeah, we're in a ton. We are very, unlike some people who they get a distributor and then the distributor decides where the stores go. I'm admittedly a control freak, and I like to know where our product is going to be. So we're very selective on what stores we go into. So apart from Crate and Barrel, pretty much 99% of the stores we go into are locally owned, like mom and pop businesses. And I like supporting them. They're supporting me. I like supporting them. I love knowing their story. They love knowing my story. And I know that they're going to take care of my product on the shelf. If I go into a grocery store, I'm a number, and I don't want to be a number. I didn't go into business. That's the one thing I'll say that I take ownership of, is I didn't go into business to become just, it isn't all about numbers for me. It isn't about like, okay, what's my quarterly report? How much are we making? I want to feel a connection to what I'm doing and to who I'm doing business with.
And if somebody just wanted to say, if somebody wants to grab a bottle of your syrup, where would be the best place to go?
In Vancouver?
Yeah.
The three stores that carry the biggest selection of our product, and we have two sizes, right? So we have a big size, this is our standard size, and then we have our really cute mini size, which is the Hula Hula, which I think some people had gotten. And Welk's on Main Street, I think they're 19th and Main, and Modern Bartender on Pender, and then Sweet Taya's also on Main Street. Yeah.
Perfect. That's great. Yeah. And then for people who are listening, I guess, who wants to launch a business and, you know, see some success in the farmer's market.
Yes.
What would be, I guess, your advice for them to grow from there?
It's interesting. This is my 12th year in business and we still do farmer's markets. And I have seen so many people come and go, and they give up too quickly because, you know, you're standing in weather, right? Like some days it's hot, some days it's rainy, some days nobody comes, but just because you had one bad day or you had one great day, that isn't your benchmark. It's marketing. So every single day that you're out there, all you need is one person to find you who's going to take interest in you. And it could be, you know, we had Whole Foods come to us. We chose not to go into Whole Foods, which people think we're crazy, but we chose not to. It was exposure there at the farmer's market. But I recommend starting with your local market and just get out there. If you have a product, it doesn't, and this is the thing too, that I recommend to everybody. Not everything has to be perfect. Not everything has to be completely 100% in place when you start. If you make a jam that you're just like, I love making jam and I love picking raspberries and I'm going to go pick raspberries all summer and just make raspberry jam and show up at the market, awesome. Your jar doesn't have to be perfect. Your label doesn't have to be perfect. I've changed my branding. Well, I haven't changed the branding has evolved and it has gotten better, but I haven't, like, every year something changes, like every year. And I used to be such a perfectionist where it's just like, okay, my display has to be perfect at the market. My banner has to be perfect. I have to have flowers on the table. I have to have everything. No, you don't. You could show up honestly with a cardboard box and people are going to come and talk to you and they're going to want to try it and they're going to come back and they're going to give you their feedback. And that's the most valuable marketing and market research you'll ever do.
And what are some of the things that you've, I guess, changed or improved upon based on people's feedback?
Our sugar, the sugar content. We now make ours, we used to make it, I guess it was like 10% less sugar than a typical simple syrup. We're now 40% less sugar, which is legally the lowest I can go. After that, you have to start adding chemicals and stabilizers. And we just chose not to do any of that. So that's the biggest change. And the one that I'm most proud of is we figured out a formula to just sort of get it as least sweet, but still sweet as possible. And then I think my packaging, like, I'm really proud. We have these like terrible little gift boxes. I'm just going to show you one. And now we have like these really cute little gift packs that are all illustrations. And yeah, and like we work with a woman who does all these illustrations for us, and we've just had a lot of fun. And everything's very playful. That's like kind of our vibe. It's like the colors speak for themselves. We don't take ourselves really seriously. When you're making a drink or a snow cone or a popsicle with our product, whatever it is, like, those are all things that should come from a place of joy, not like, I'm eating diet food and I want to lose weight. It's not like that. It's like, hey, we're having a party and let's go do this. And yeah.
For sure. Oh, it looks like people want to know why you chose to not go with Whole Foods.
Oh, well, good question. They are... It's a very corporate environment. And the irony is I was I'm actually from New York originally, and I was a buyer. I was a gourmet food buyer in New York City before I did the music thing. And Whole Foods came and headhunted me. This is before Whole Foods had even, didn't have another store outside of Texas. And I poo-pooed them then. And I said, oh, that's crazy, because they wanted me to go move from New York to Texas. And I was like, I am not moving to Texas. Silly me. But they came to me, and it didn't feel right. It was too corporate. I would be lost on the shelves. And they've changed their rules where you have to work with a distributor. And that's the other thing. The other advice I would give people is there are two types of business people, right? There are money people who understand the finance side of it. And then there are the creative people who 99% of the time never understand the finances. And you've got to get your pricing in line in order to even consider being picked up by a distributor. Because a distributor, like food margins anyway, are super, super small. You're not, unless you're going to make like the next, you know, Dove bar or, you know, Twinkie or something. I can't even think of anything popular, but like something really big, like you can scale easily. You're not making, you're going to scale it and you can sell all around the world. You're not going to really make a bazillion dollars in the food business. Most people do it is because they're just passionate about the food. Right? I'm just passionate about ingredients. I'm passionate about my community and farmers. And I love every year working with the farmers. And we work a lot on farms during the summer for that connection. But yeah, sorry. I like to go on tangents. The Whole Foods was just way too corporate, and we would have just had to give away a lot of our profit margins, which are so small anyway, to a distributor.
Yeah, no, that is fair. And we've actually had a couple of more, I guess, beverage companies or food companies coming in during VSW actually talking about, it's the same story, how margin is so small in the food and beverage industry, and you really have to know your numbers and making sure that it works.
I didn't realize how much you need to know it down to a penny. And that's in any business, like you need to know it to a penny. And last year with COVID, that was like one of the biggest challenges, is because of the supply chain issues, prices were all over the map. Like, you know, something that might have cost me a dollar then cost me $1.25, and the next week was $1.35, and the next week was $1.15. So it was, I mean, how do you can't keep going and changing your prices in the store. Like, people will be like, what's going on over here? So you kind of eat the cost a little bit, hoping that it'll stabilize. But what's happened in the last 4 months is packaging and ingredients have jumped a solid 17%, which I'm sure most of you have gone to the grocery store and are like, why are all the groceries so expensive? I mean, there's a million and one reasons for it, but I don't think that's going to change. I think that increase is here to stay, unfortunately. Yeah.
That's sad to hear.
It is, and it's really frustrating too, but...
Oh, yeah. Well, it is what it is. I guess we're seeing light at the end of the tunnel. Hopefully, yeah. we'll get out of this restriction soon. I don't want to take too much of your time now, because, you know, we still have that interactive portion. So I wanted to make a cocktail or you look like you have everything in front of you already. So
I always do. I'm always at the ready. I always have a full bar set up.
Yeah, so in our experience box, we do have the hula syrup, I believe. And then, so we wanted to kind of like let you show us a drink that you really like with it. And then I'm getting my team here. I'm getting fancy. I'm like, you know, 100% paying attention to this, but I may be handed a drink to me by the end of this. So I'm not the one like, you know, mixing and trying to like pour water over laptop is never a good idea. No. So So go ahead and show us how to make a drink.
Okay, well, I'm gonna just give you the basics. So on our regular size bottle, we do have a little illustration that basically shows you that you use 1 to 2 tablespoons to make the drink. That's all you need. But again, this is an ingredient. It's not set in stone. I know people get a little tripped up on that, but this is an ingredient and you're going to use it according to your taste. So to make a soda, I would do 1 to 2 tablespoons Pellegrino. If you don't have a soda stream, you can use, are you sniffing the hula hula? For those of you who don't know, this this is my version of the Hawaiian drink, Pog. So Pog is passion fruit, orange, and guava. And it's trademarked by a milk company in Hawaii. So we couldn't use the name Pog. And then writing passion fruit, orange, and guava, and then writing it in French would have just been I would need a whole newspaper for that. So anyway, so this is very tropical. This is my homage to Hawaii, where we all started, which, by the way, we still shave ice. We still shave ice in Squamish and Whistler. So anybody who wants to come up, come and get a snow cone and say hi. But if I'm going to make a cocktail, a tiki style drink would be classic with this. So a tiki style drink typically goes into a tall glass. I'm a big fan of filling the glass with filling the glass with a lot of ice. And you can do two things. You can just put all the ingredients in here and give it a stir, which is realistically what most people do. Or if you kind of feel like you're Tom Cruise from Cocktail, you can bust out the cocktail shaker and do all the fancy stuff. But I'll be honest with you, every time I do that, my drink is all over the place. I'm like a hot, hot mess with that. So I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to show you the basic one. So you're going to open this. I use the jigger. I couldn't think of the name, sorry. The jigger to do about half ounce. This is a half ounce and an ounce. Half ounce in there. And you could just do this with, I usually cut up some limes into quarters and I squeeze it in there. But I also throw the lime in. And this is, you're getting the essential oils from the lime rind. If you don't like things with a bitter edge, just squeeze the lime and get rid of it. If you put the whole thing in, the rind will give an extra different kind of flavor. So just be mindful of that. So now you've got lime juice, you've got cordial. If you want to just go as a mocktail for anybody who is pregnant or is deciding not to drink, I would do something as simple as tonic. So Fentimans makes a great tonic. I would do that and top it up. And then you could put a sprig of, I have mint, actually, just so you know, I have like lemon balm, lemon verbena, lavender, and mint here. But if I was doing a mocktail, I would probably just put a little piece of mint in. And then I would top up with the tonic. But we're going to do a cocktail. So we've got the hula hula. We've got the lime. Sorry, that's gin. I don't need gin. And we're going to do tequila. So you could do a light rum, a dark rum, mezcal, and different types of tequila, all depending on your preference. My preference actually is mezcal, which has a smokiness to it. It adds a super interesting complexity to the cocktail. But again, I'm going to, and I like a stiff drink, like there's no holding back to it. So I'm going for the full ounce in there. And then you can just give it a quick stir. You want to make sure that these three ingredients are kind of mixed together. When you're also stirring and you're stirring the mint in there, or you're stirring with the lime rind, every time the metal is touching it, it's releasing the oils and we're now releasing flavor. So you're cooking a drink. And then you would just finish it right off the bat. Little Pellegrino. Or we're going to do it twofold. You got Pellegrino, but my favorite, but I like to lighten it. So I do half Pellegrino and half ginger beer. So ginger beer gives it that full tropical vibe. So you've got the ginger, you've got the passion fruit, orange, guava, lime, a little bit of mint, and this right here. And the reason why I put the Pellegrino in, it lightens up that syrupiness, because unless if you get a really dry ginger beer is quite sweet. So you want to kind of, yeah. So I like that little balance. And then you've got your cocktail. And then you can garnish it, or you can, I like to drink it with straw, but I see you've got a cocktail already.
I got this now, and then I have to do the, you know, the influencer pose to make it show up on screen.
Well done.
Not as fancy as yours. Don't have any of the herbal
not
lime
fancy,
or anything.
Not
in it.
fancy at all, but you guys
Look
got
at
it.
it. Yeah, so I just wanted to cheers to Peggy and to Frostbite for actually closing off with VSW. You're actually our last session for the whole week. So it's
fun.
A perfect.
Well, it's perfect to end it with a cocktail. I hope everyone else has a drink or at least goes and has a little Friday happy hour.
Exactly. And that's why we're very happy to share. I'm ready for this drink now. We're very
Asia
happy to share
drinking
this.
Already. Yeah.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. So I'm very happy to have you here. I want to do a cheers. Thank you so much for being a part of VSW.
Thank you so much for letting me natter on, everybody. And please come see me at a farmer's market if you have any specific questions, and or come visit me in Squamish.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Wow, this is awesome.
What are you drinking?
The whole drink. What did I get mixed? It's the hula hula syrup.
With?
Grapefruit. Sparkling water.
Fun.
There's no alcohol in there because I'm still technically working.
Yeah.
So, you Wait. Know, the second one. Yeah, so for everybody who's watching, thank you so much for being a part of VSW, and thank you so much for staying until the last session to stay with us. Yeah, we are wrapping up. We're done. If you're in Vancouver, make sure that you... It's sunny right now. Well, it's not raining at least. So come out. The BC Place will be shining, we'll be showing the VSW colors to celebrate our wrap up for this whole week. So yeah, if you're out and about, make sure you check that out. And on top of that, thanks again. And thank you, Peggy, so much for sharing
thank
your
you.
Story, for getting us your drinks. We're very happy. This is the first one, is the, you know, the mocktail, but
yeah.
I'm going to have a second drink. So, yeah, thank you so much. And we hope to see you around, and I'm going to find you in Squamish and Whistler, and we can try
thank
some
you.
More flavors.
Please do. Thanks, everybody.